Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I welcome the viewers of Peace TV once again with the greetings of peace. As you all know that we are going through the interview with Sheikh Suleiman Salem from USA on the topic of trials and tribulations. In the previous episodes, we learned what do we mean by trials and tribulations, and also how did our aslaf, how did the Sahaba Ikram and the community of the Muslims in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam overcome these trials and tribulations of life. In today's episode, we would like to know more from the Sheikh that what more perspectives are there to deal with the fitna, with the trials and tribulations, so that we develop a good attitude towards it and think that this is for our good, for our benefit in this worldly life as well as in the hereafter.
Barakallahu feek. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. So in regards to this topic of fitna and hardships, oftentimes we forget that the people before us are tested. We forget everyone else while we are being tested. While we go through these struggles, we think that we are the worst situation in the world. We are going through the biggest struggle in the world. And so a person has to often remember those who are less fortunate, those who are also struggling maybe on a bigger level, to the point where many people don't realize that if you're going through a hardship, someone else out there is wishing and praying to be in your shoes, just to have what you have. And so we have to be grateful. Gratitude is a big part of getting through these hardships. Now we can also remember the verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he tells us, when he's speaking to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions, and they're saying, أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَن تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةِ أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَن تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةِ Do you expect to enter paradise when what? وَلَمَّا يَأْتِكُمْ مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ خَلَوْا مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ And you were given the examples and the stories and narrations of those who came before you. مَسَّتْهُمُ الْبَأْسَاءُ وَالضَّرَّاءُ وَزُلْزِلُوا They were afflicted with severe poverty and with severe hardships. وَزُلْزِلُوا They were shaken. What kind of shaking is this? وَزُلْزِلُوا حَتَّى يَقُولَ الرَّسُولُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ مَتَى نَصْرُ اللَّهِ Until even the Prophet, that Prophet that was afflicted, and those who are around him who believed, they asked, مَتَى نَصْرُ اللَّهِ When will the help of Allah come? When will the victory of Allah come? When will this relief come to us? أَلَا إِنَّ نَصْرَ اللَّهِ قَرِيبٌ Verily the help of Allah is nearby. But be patient. Be patient. Now Allah is asking the believers, أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَن تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةِ And this is verse 214 of Surah Al-Baqarah. Are you expecting to enter paradise? And yet you were given the stories and narrations of those before you. And they were tested. They were tested severely. So do you expect not to be patient, not to be tested, and to enter paradise freely like this with no test or trial whatsoever? And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us that there are hardships and people went through hardships, and anyone who wants to get to paradise has to strive for paradise. Paradise is not free. You have to work for it. Now if paradise is free, all of us would enter immediately. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from Ahlul Jannah, from the dwellers of paradise. Now I want to ask you a question. Have you ever seen a child cry? Like a young child, like a toddler, or maybe 5 or 6 years old. Have you ever seen a child cry?
Yes, of course.
Of course. Maybe you were the one crying. Or maybe
no,
you...
I don't remember though.
Maybe you caused a child to cry. No, I'm kidding. But the reality is when you see this child crying, when you see the child crying, you realize that this child is in a bubble, this small space. In their mind, whatever they're crying about, for example, if a child, their toy is broken, they want a new toy and their toy is broken, or something happened to one of their possessions, their toys. So the child is crying, and you see this child crying as a grown-up, and you look at them and you see from your perspective, outside of this bubble, outside of this struggle, you see that everything is going to be okay. It's fine, it's not a big deal, as big as the child thinks it is. But if you go into the mind of the child, their entire life is in this bubble, and so they're crying and crying and crying. And they need someone to comfort them. And so you mentioned you've seen a child cry, unless you made the child cry. So you comfort this child. You comfort this child. So while you're comforting this child, the child feels a little bit of relief. You know, when you comfort a child over and over and you tell them, it will be fine. It will be okay. So the child starts to be relieved. And you think as an adult, as you grow up, you think you know best. We human beings think we know best, that we're smart and we're intellectuals. And the reality is, as we get older, the struggles also rise. Meaning the struggles that come our way, the hardships that come our way, are not the same struggles and hardships that the child experiences. So you're not going to cry over, you know, a toy or something. You're not going to cry over something small that is missing or broken, although some adults do. And so as an adult, as a grown-up, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you different types of struggles and hardships based on a few things, such as your age and your faith and your experience in life, where you are in your life, what you went through in life. And so these hardships come your way. These hardships come your way. Now, some grown-ups, they do understand this. They do understand that Allah is taking care of them. And so they're patient with their new struggles. They do understand that as you get older, your struggles will also increase and they will change in their reality. And so a person who does not understand that as a grown-up, they will feel the pain and they will only look at the pain and they won't understand the nature of the struggle. So what happens to this grown-up is that they are going back to the place or the shoes of this child. Now they have taken themselves back to the position of when they were children, crying and thinking that everything is in this bubble. But Allah is comforting you as an adult, as someone who has some knowledge, the little limited knowledge that Allah gives us. You have some understanding and comprehension that as you, as an adult, you comforted this child, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His own way, He's comforting you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you that with hardship comes ease. إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. He's telling you that reality, that with every hardship, there is ease. And Allah is telling you that when you are patient, Allah is rewarding you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with those who are patient. إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. And there are many examples of this. And the angels, when they come to the people of Jannah, imagine we're entering paradise, and I ask Allah to make us of Ahlul Jannah.
Ameen.
When the people of paradise are entering paradise, the angels come to them and they say what? They salamun alaykum. They say salamun alaykum bima sabartum. Peace be upon you with what you are patient with, for what you persevered in patience. And so these trials that we go through, when we are patient, we understand that Allah is comforting us. And we turn to the Quran. We turn back to Allah. We turn back in dua and supplication in the midst of the night. We turn back to our Creator for help through these struggles, knowing that as we comforted that child who doesn't know any better, we might not know any better, and Allah is comforting us. And so we need to understand that. We need to grasp this reality, and this is the first step, to understand that the struggles you go through, Allah is comforting you through these struggles. But if you choose to ignore Allah and to be impatient with your struggles, and you're turning yourself away from Allah, then how do you expect yourself to be helped? How do you expect to find peace and tranquility? And so this peace and tranquility is through understanding that the Creator is helping the creation, especially those who are grown-ups. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is helping them through their struggles and through their hardships. And so when we talk about the child crying, we have to realize that after a while, you will experience struggle after struggle. And if you get through it, Allah will purify you. Allah will reward you. Allah will bless you. Allah will raise your status and rank. Allah will elevate your rank in paradise. There are so many blessings and virtues of being patient. And so as a trial comes your way and you pass this trial, you get through your hardship with patience and with gratitude towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you become stronger. And then another trial comes and you become stronger. And your iman, your faith continues to increase and increase and increase. And every struggle that comes your way makes you stronger and stronger and stronger. And this is what happens to the one who passes through their struggles and through their trials and tests and tribulations. So these fitna, when they come our way, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who are strong so that we pass through them with patience and with perseverance and with sincerity and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He will help us in the same way that we expect to help others who are being helped. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Creator, is more merciful than we can imagine. He is more merciful than you and I. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created mercy in 100 parts, and we only have one part divided up amongst the creation. One part. So everything you see that's merciful, the compassion that we have towards one another, this is only one part combined all of mankind. And Allah is saving 99 parts of mercy with Him for the day of resurrection to give to mankind. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows when we go through hardships. He knows when you're struggling. He knows that you're going through this thing that you don't desire, this thing that is not relieving for you. And yet He is helping you through it without ways that you don't understand, in ways that you do not understand. And that there is wisdom for you going through this hardship that might bring you closer to Him or lead you to learn something new in your life or to become disciplined and stronger as a believer, to raise your status in Jannah and as a firm believer in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Jazakallahu khairan, barakallahu feek, Shaykh. MashaAllah, we learned many of the advices from the Shaykh that how could we as Muslims overcome the trials and tribulations of life other than strong faith, tawakkul in Allah, and then having firm trust in Allah, the patience and the shukr, that is being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, besides having a sense of responsibility that we Muslims have to lead the mankind from the darkness of kufr to the light of Islam. Sheikh, now we would like to move on to another aspect of this trials and tribulations that many of the Muslim brethren today, they consider the acts of worship that which we do, the ibadah that which we do, to be a sense of difficulty for them. They find it very difficult. And I would say that the most common and the most often for farz that which Allah has obligated over us is the salah. So while offering their salah, they think that to be as something very difficult. So how should a Muslim practically overcome this feeling of considering the ibadah to be a trial, a tribulation, and rather make that as the coolness of their eyes?
Barakallahu feek. That's a beautiful question. And this is a very important topic and a very important subject, because oftentimes many Muslims, they won't understand the point of ibadah, the point of rituals and acts of worship. And so many people, they will feel like these things are a burden. And so when this burden comes their way, they'll feel like they're wasting their time. Why should I do this? Why am I doing this? And then they will try to find some kind of worldly explanation, some kind of worldly reason to do this action, some kind of worldly benefit in doing this action. And they don't understand that the true sweetness is sweetness in the acts of worship. And that this only comes to the one who gives. Meaning, if you give to your salah, then your salah will give to you. If you put in that act of worship, you put in the effort to understand the salah, to have khushu' and concentration in the salah, to give the salah its right on time, to make the salah slow and tranquil and peaceful, and to make as much dua and as possible in the salah, when you're giving the salah more, then you will get more out of the salah. When you're giving more to your ibadah, you'll get more out of your ibadah. But if you don't understand the reason for doing it, and you don't want to do it, this will make it more difficult for a person. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to say, أَرِحْنَا بِهَا يَا بِلَال. Make the adhan, Bilal, and give us this relief of the salah. And that the salah has been made a coolness to his eyes. So the salah, when you experience it, you're supposed to take out of it this sweetness. You're supposed to take out of it this fruit, these blessings, this happiness. And so the people that don't understand the nature of the salah, they are usually the ones who feel that the salah is a burden. Whereas when you really think about it, the salah is a gift. The salah is a gift, and it opens the doors to many sources of blessings and mercy and protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If only we comprehended, if only we truly understood and implemented the virtue of salah in our lives. Now the salah, when some people say they struggle without praying, they are actually not saying that they are going through a struggle. What they are actually going through is a symptom of a disease. And that is the disease of the heart, disease of the heart. So for example, when you don't feed your body, when you stop feeding your body, you become deficient. And as you go through, you know, hour after hour after hour of not eating and drinking, your body becomes weaker and weaker. And if you go for a few days, then you will start to notice severe symptoms of this weakness. For example, if you don't eat for a few days, when you go through this disease, you'll start to see the symptoms around you in every day of your life. And you'll start to realize that I need to feed my body in order to cure myself. So the people who are struggling with salah, they need to understand the following point. When you are struggling with salah, that struggle of not praying, that is not the true struggle.
Jazakallahu khairan, Shaykh. We will continue this important discussion, but after a break. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Welcome back after the break. We were talking to Shaykh Suleiman Salem about the importance of the salah and how to consider the salah to be a source of gift for a Muslim, not a difficulty, not a burden over him. Shaykh Salem.
Barakallahu fi. And so we began mentioning how if a person is struggling with salah, they are struggling with any act of worship, it is because they don't fully understand the context and the picture of our servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so if you don't feed your body will become sick and you will start to see the symptoms. And if you don't feed your soul and nourish your soul will become sick. And when your soul becomes sick, you will stop enjoying the salah. When your heart becomes diseased, you will stop enjoying reciting the Quran. You will stop enjoying these other things that we are supposed to be doing. Now the salah itself, if people really understood the importance of salah, nobody would neglect it. Not a single one of the 1.8 billion Muslims in our day and age would neglect the salah, because the salah holds the highest priority in Islam. After you believe and submit that there is only one creator, and you testify, La ilaha illallah, so you testify there is none worthy of worship except Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his final messenger. So after you testify, the first and most important thing after that is the salah. Before anything else, before any of the prohibitions or other obligations, the salah is number one in Islam. It is your divine link to the Creator. Imagine for a moment, think for a moment about all the acts of worship that were prescribed, all the things that were revealed from Jibreel alayhi salam to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Allah sent Jibreel down to convey this message to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The salah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to him to give him the salah. The salah is a gift. The salah is a gift. And if people knew the rewards and the virtues and the blessings of salah, they would not slack off with the salah. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will question us about the salah when on the Day of Judgment. As we mentioned before, it would be first on the Day of Resurrection. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in the meeting of that the first thing that a servant will be brought to account for on the Day of Judgment, meaning the first thing the Creator will ask us about on the Day of Judgment, is a salah, the prayer. If it was done well, then this person, everything after that will go well for them. Meaning, it's a path to paradise. And if it was not done well, if it was slacking off, if the obligatory parts were missing, and they were not done on time, then this person will be doomed, as the Prophet ﷺ said. The salah is the thing that you should never ever leave. The salah is the pillar that you never give up. You never even consider missing the salah. The salah is your food for the hereafter. Your guarantee for paradise, meaning that if you take care of your salah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, this is when Allah will give you a guarantee as a protection. But if you do not take care of your salah, especially the obligatory prayers, then there is no guarantee from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so we take care of the salah in order to have this guarantee and also to enjoy the salah. Now some people, when they come to the salah, they don't realize. They think that all I'm doing is acts of movements. I'm just moving about and I'm saying things. And so we need to first understand what we are saying in the salah. We need to understand this Surah Al-Fatiha that you are reciting, it's a supplication. It's a supplication and it will cure you through your struggles and hardships. It will cure the diseases of the heart. It will cure your soul and feed your soul at the same time. So this Surah Al-Fatiha alone, when we recite it, we should understand it. When we say Allahu Akbar in the prayer, we are saying Allah, the Creator, is greater. Greater than what? Greater than everything in this life. You're throwing away this life. Because now you are focused, now you are praying, now you are speaking to the Creator. You have an appointment with the Creator 5 times a day. Do not miss your appointment. If you miss the appointment, you're risking your own punishment on the Day of Resurrection. And you have no one to blame but yourself. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us 50 prayers at first. And it was reduced and reduced and reduced. Now it is 5 prayers with the reward of 50. So you take care of these 5 prayers and you have the reward of 50 prayers. And so when you take care of the salah and you do the acts of salah, take long in your sujood, take long in your ruku'ah, in your prostration, your bowing. Take long and focus on your dua. Ask Allah to help you. Spill your heart out to Allah and Allah will help you with your problems. Allah will help you enjoy the salah. But when you rush through the salah and you don't give it its right, you're not going to take anything out of it. You're fulfilling the minimum, the burden, but you're not going to take any enjoyment out of it. So if you want to enjoy the act of worship, do it as it should be done and enjoy it as it should be enjoyed and understand the context of the coolness of this act. The sweetness of salah is making dua. Because imagine for a moment that your phone, you go to another country, as I'm here in another country, and you go to this country and now you don't have a signal anymore. So what happens to your phone? It starts to roam, you know, roaming. So when it starts roaming, it's looking for other signals, other ways of having a connection. And we're not comparing our connection to Allah with a smartphone. However, when you think about it, if you are not connecting to Allah, and you become diseased, you don't like the salah anymore, you don't enjoy the salah, you don't take care of the salah, you're pulling yourself away from that connection, and your heart will naturally connect to something else. Whether it's the dunya, or a desire, or somebody, or something, your heart will go somewhere else. And we ask Allah to protect us from that.
Ameen.
And so this salah is a form of a cure for our hardships. The salah, a lot of people, when they used to go through their hardships, they used to go and pray. The sahaba and the companions, the tabi'een, oftentimes they would have hardships. When it's time for salah, they would find relief. That is the relief. So if you want to find your relief, give the salah its right. And know that between every 2 prayers, Allah is forgiving your sins. And in the salah, Allah is forgiving your sins. And with the wudu, the ablution, Allah is forgiving your sins. It's a form of a blessing. And when you pray, when you take care of your salah as it should be done, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects you from going astray. Inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. Absolutely. So it will protect you from going astray and from feeling disconnected to Allah in committing the other sins. And we have many examples of people who go through these incidents in their lives when they stop praying or they don't give the salah its right. And so when they go through these incidents, they realize after a while, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides many of them because they are sincere. They realize what they are missing out on. And many people, this is a real question, many people when they go to the graves, all they're really wishing for is what? To come back to this life, right? So the person who passes away, especially those who are evil, what do they say? In Surah Al-Mu'minun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about these people, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَهُمُ الْمَوْتِ قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ. For what? لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْتُ. So that I can do something good with what I left behind. So that I can pray two rak'ahs. I want to come back and pray. I want to come back and take care of my salah. My brothers and sisters, we all have to understand this concept of salah. When we pass away, we wish to come back just to pray to Allah. One more prayer. And imagine that salah you decide to miss, you decide to skip a prayer. Imagine you don't get another chance to pray. How sad is that person's situation? Wallahi, it is frightening and it shakes us that you can consider missing the salah, something as valuable as the salah. The salah is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a cure for our hardships and struggles, and it is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to keep us connected to Him. So you feed yourself 5 times a day minimum. You connect to the Creator 5 times a day. You talk to Him 5 times a day, and this divine link between the creation and the Creator becomes solidified until the day you die. Imagine you die and every single day you connected to Allah as He asked 5 times a day. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to take care of the salah and to enjoy the salah and to make it the coolness of our eyes.
Jazakallahu khairan, Shaykh. We realize that people have been looking for different arenas for success, but we fail to realize that the muadhin is calling for success, hayya 'alal falah, 5 times in a day. This is where the success lies, the success of this worldly life and the life to come. Jazakallah khair, Shaykh, for sharing your valuable knowledge with us, and how could a Muslim treat this very important act of worship as a source of blessing for him, but not as a burden. Inshallah, we will continue more about the trials and tribulations of this life and the trials that which the contemporary world or the people in the contemporary world are facing today, inshallah, in the coming episodes. Until then, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.